Alleluia, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, who through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, overcame death and opened to us the gate of everlasting life, grant that we who celebrate with joy the day of the Lord's resurrection may be raised from the death of sin by your life-giving Spirit, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. I am about to create new heavens and a new earth. The former things shall not be remembered or come to mind. But be glad and rejoice forever in what I am creating. For I am about to create Jerusalem as a joy, and its people as a delight. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and delight in my people. No more shall the sound of weeping be heard in it, or the cry of distress. No more shall there be in it an infant that lives but a few days, or an old person who does not live without a lifetime. For one who dies at 100 years will be considered a youth, and one who falls short of 100 will be considered accursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For like the days of a tree shall the days of my people be, and my chosen shall long enjoy the work of their hands. They shall not labor in vain or bear children for calamity, for they shall be offspring blessed by the Lord, and their descendants as well. Before they call, I will answer. While they are yet speaking, I will hear. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together. The lion shall eat straw like an ox, but the serpent, its food shall be dust. They shall not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, says the Lord. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. Glory to you, Lord Christ. On the first day of the week, at early dawn, the women who had come with Jesus from Galilee came to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, and when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified, and on the third day rise again." Then they remembered these words, and returning from the tomb, they told all this to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other woman with them, who told this to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter got up and ran to the tomb, stooping and looking. He saw the linen clothes by themselves. Then he went home amazed at what had happened. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May the God of hope fill us with all joy and peace in believing, so that we may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Alleluia, he is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. The celebration we have anticipated with eager longing is here. Today's celebration is even with more of what feels familiar, comforting, and dare I say, even normal. The celebration of Easter nonetheless continues to be about news that is as shocking as it is profound. While good news is what the word gospel literally means, in our own day of tweeting, texting, Instagramming, news that we encounter this day still leaves us astounded. How can this be? Too many times we find ourselves with news that we're certainly not anticipating and find ourselves unprepared to fully take in. And on this day, that's what we're confronted with as well. Shocking news, unexpected, and certainly perplexing. World events such as Ukraine and even our own local news can illustrate that the news can send us reeling and perhaps even make us recall far too many more tragedies, profound disappointments, either on a personal or even societal level. Too many situations, far too much news that is shocking that we cannot fully comprehend. Is that what was happening with these first hearers? This Easter may well find you once more in the midst of wonder, reflection, and perhaps even anxiety about what is to come in the near future. But today is about an event that shakes the very foundations of what we had accepted, how we defined or rather limited life. We hear, he has risen. Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you that while he was still in Galilee, the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified, and on the third day rise again. Although they recalled this, this news that something has happened is shocking, and it changes the very basis of how we can see the world, let alone understand ourselves and others, even life and death itself. This news not only has implications for how we see our future, but can affect how we are here and now, how we live. And when we welcome this news into our whole selves, step into what it means. To heed this news will change the way we can see life itself. Now, no matter how many times we experience the celebration of this day, Easter is, above all else, about mystery. That we, as well as those first witnesses 2,000 years ago, cannot fully understand by our limited experience alone. Easter, therefore, is beyond a single day or an event, but rather a whole movement and full gift from God. And it comes to us precisely at some of the most profound, disappointing places we can imagine. In our good news, it comes to us an empty tomb, confronting what we have come to expect about life, death, and now the power of God's love beyond our limited experience alone. Ours is a faith that provides hope, strength, and courage for what is seemingly otherwise devastation. What the world would otherwise call disappointment or tragedy, which in turn creates the power to not only cope with the situation, but makes it simply another passage in our lives. But hope is not a throwaway word. The late beloved Archbishop Desmond Tutu reminds us in one of his writings that for us as Easter people, hope is not just another pleasantry we exchange. Hope is not the same thing as optimism, but a far deeper thing, and it does not depend on the superficial, but sees more than what our society says we can or should see of ourselves or others. Hope is what we trust to guide and direct how we live, move, and have our being. The good news of resurrection is that resurrection follows death. It is to be the basis of our identity and our purpose, even as messy as life can get. We do not know why things happen the way they do, but we know that God can bring life out of the darkness and silence and of death itself. Even when we do not know how or understand the mystery itself, ours is to embrace and live into. All of the saving works of God that we celebrate are more than history. They are what creates our story. And although we know this story, find it familiar, comforting, and nonetheless, we arrive at Good Friday each year recalling the pain, the suffering that Jesus, the Son of God himself, did not escape, but faced with confidence because of who God is presently and pointing towards the future. When you reread the four accounts of that scene of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and the reactions of the people, the feelings may seem all too familiar, but what was true then remains true today, that God was, is, and will be present, although they could not always see God in the way they related to it. And God is here with us now. We may not always have all the answers or totally understand what feels like mystery, but by the grace, the gift of God, Easter is that invitation to have our lives renewed and made whole. And as such, we too can believe and trust in the message of an Easter faith. Today, the shockingly good news is that new life has begun yet again, not just with the pandemic, but in your life and mine, where we find ourselves living. And part of this great and mysterious gift of Easter is the invitation from God to allow Easter to be more than an event or a single day or holiday, but rather the catalyst to what it promises, new life, and hope that can dispel the darkest of times. To heed this good news is to accept new life, but that's not all. To accept this gift also requires a willingness and deliberate action to release the hold of what has passed, the events of this past year or even longer, and what they've placed in our lives. I believe we must trust God and release our fears, the old life, releasing the burdens and sorrows that accompany it, making room for new life to take hold and flourish. That is ultimately our choice, though. Together with God's help, the faith and joy of this Easter faith can and will grow and make all things new, even you and me. For behold, we all have incredibly good news. Alleluia, he is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Let us reaffirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people today is a litany of thanksgiving found on page 836 in the Book of Common Prayer. Let us give thanks to God our Father for all his gifts so freely bestowed upon us, for the beauty and wonder of your creation in earth and sky and sea. We thank you, Lord, for all that is gracious in the lives of men and women, revealing the image of Christ. We thank you, Lord, for our daily food and drink, our homes and families and our friends. We thank you, Lord, for minds to think and hearts to give and hands to serve. We thank you, Lord, for health and strength to work and leisure to rest and play. We thank you, Lord, for the brave and courageous who are patient in suffering and faithful in adversity. We thank you, Lord, for all valiant seekers after truth, liberty, and justice. We thank you, Lord, for the communion of saints in all times and places. We thank you, Lord. Above all, we give you thanks for the great mercies and promises given to us in Christ Jesus our Lord. To him be praise and glory with you, O Father and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the Word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days, you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where, with Mary, the God-bearer, Thomas, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia! Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia!
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Come, you are part of the kingdom. Using the prayer adapted by the National Cathedral, a spiritual communion is a personal devotional that anyone can pray at any time to express their desire to receive Holy Communion at that moment, but in which circumstances impede them from actually receiving Holy Communion physically. As we share in communion in one way or another, let us pray. Beloved Jesus, I believe that you are present in the Blessed Sacrament of the altar. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you in the sacrament of your body and blood, come spiritually into my heart. I embrace you and unite myself entirely to you. Let me never be separated from you in this life or in the life to come. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God.